What is strabismus? How do we go about and define this pathological condition of the eye, which is known as strabismus? It's again very interesting. It's basically the inability to align the eyes simultaneously when a person is looking at a distant object and it's basically a fixed position out there. So this condition, this misalignment, is known as the strabismic condition, or in a layman terminology, we can also term it as the squinting of the eyes. Now, what basically happens is, whenever we are saying that the person is strabismic, we usually give the misconception that the person is amblyopic. Now, amblyopia and strabismus are two distinct entities. Basically, strabismus, again, obviously the clinical picture is the same. We have the cross in, or we have the deviation of the eyes seen in strabismus as well as in amblyopia. And sometimes amblyopia, which is basically known as the lazy eye when we talk about it, which is due to the weakness of the extraocular muscles, that is why we have the cross in or the cross out phenomena. And sometimes strabismus can itself give rise to this amblyopic condition, or one of the eyes becomes the lazy eye over here. So it's again very important to distinguish these two entities and to diagnose the case correctly, whether the patient is suffering from amblyopia or whether it is a case of strabismus. So knowing the differences, even in a clinical presentation, or even when you're giving out the analysis or documenting the case of strabismus, is again very important to clinically give your proof that this person is suffering from strabismus, or whether he or she is suffering from amblyopia. So over here in this particular section, we'll be focusing on the definition of strabismus. How do you go about and define this condition is again very important. The misalignment is the major factor over here when we talk about it. It's basically a condition which is usually occurring unilaterally. So what basically happens, or what is the underlying pathology behind this complete phenomena, is that one of the eyes is looking in a proper manner, is looking straight, and the other eye is basically crossed in, crossed out, or whether it is deviated superiorly, or either it is deviated inferiorly. So all of these deviations will get their perfect terminologies when we talk about the types. But over here, I'm just focusing on the fact that there is a deviation in the affected eye. So what basically happens after this strabismic phenomena is that the eye which is deviated becomes, sometimes it also becomes a lazy eye, and the conditions of strabismus and amblyopia are sometimes overimposed or superimposed. So this is the underlying pathology. The vision of the person would obviously be affected when he or she is suffering from this strabismic kind of a condition. There will be a poor vision, and the brain is going to interpret the image that the brain is getting from the normal eye, not from the affected eye. So the interpretation would be from the normal eye, and usually the affected eye is going to become lazy. It's going to become affected. The vision is going to be affected in the lazy eye, or in the affected eye, or the eye which is suffering from strabismus. So it's again very important to address these cases of strabismus as early as possible, because whenever the parent notices that the eyes are misaligned of an infant, it's a normal phenomena that the eyes are going to be misaligned in the 3 to 4 months of age. But older than that, the child should be able to align the eyes. If the child has is suffering from the misalignment even after the infancy period, that is, he or she is more than 1 year of old, so that is basically defined as a strabismic eye. We get the children in the OPDs suffering from strabismus, or the parents would give you a history that the eyes are misaligned, and on the other hand, sometimes we will notice or the squinting or the strabismus in the adults. The causative factors are obviously different in the children and the adults. Over here, we'll be also discussing in this section the causative factors which are relating to the strabismus. It can be, some of the causes can be due to the birth trauma, the conditions during the birth. All of these conditions are going to manifest as strabismus in the child. Then we'll be discussing the additional classifications over here. causative factors is one of the way we can categorize these patients. And on the other hand, we have the other classifications. And we'll be discussing all of these additional classifications over here. We'll be moving on even to the particular risk factors that are related to the condition of this strabismus in the children or in the adults. There are these particular pro-conditions which make the person more prone to the development of strabismus. It can be some kind of a weakness. It can be some sorts of syndromes that the patient is suffering from. The muscular weakness, the nerve damage, trauma, infections, all of these can manifest as strabismus in a person. So we'll be discussing all of this over here in this very first section. While we move on to the definition of strabismus, the particular terminology we use whenever we are defining this condition of strabismus is again very important. It occurs when both eyes do not look at the same place at the same time. The eyes are unable to align properly under the normal conditions. So it's a normal kind of a condition. There is, the person is not suffering from some sort of a trauma or some sort of a coup and contact injuries in the occipital region, not any nerve damage, but he or she is unable to align the eyes properly. This condition is known as strabismus in the person. So this definition, it has its own categories. So we have to define these terminologies accordingly when we are defining this case of strabismus over here. So you can see the misalignment. It can be across in phenomena. It can be across out, superiorly, inferiorly, depending upon the case. We're going to define or we are going to label, categorize the case accordingly over here. The eyes may turn in, out, up or down. So all of these superior, inferior deviations, cross in, cross out deviations are given the terminologies accordingly. Can be present in one eye, that will be a unilateral condition. Can be present in both eyes, as seen even in this case. You can see that the patient is suffering from strabismus in both eyes. Both eyes are deviated inwards, are deviated medially in this particular patient. Can be seen in one or both eyes. Can be referred as a cross-eyed phenomena. So the layman terminologies are squints, crossing in, crossing out, wandering eyes. These are the normal layman terminologies that we usually use. Also, cock eye, weak eye, wall eye, or eye turns. So these are the normal terminologies that we usually use. The result of the lack of coordination between the muscles of the eye responsible for the eye movement. So this is the underlying pathology behind the development of strabismus in a person. It is basically resulting due to the lack of the coordination between the muscles of the eyes. It can be due to the weakness of the muscles, due to the nerve damage of the muscles. Whatever the case may be, we have to deal the case according to the causative factors, the problems with nerves that transmit the information to the eye muscles. So it's one of the problems that it can occur with the nerves. The nerves can be damaged due to multiple causes. It can be infections, inflammatory conditions, autoimmune diseases. It can be traumatic conditions. It can be some sort of tumorous condition. So all of these problems can result in a nerve damage. Even some sort of surgeries can result in some sort of or some degrees of strabismus in the patients. The problems with control center in the brain that directs the eye movement is again very important, that you basically, the misinterpretation of messages by the occipital lobe of the brain is again one of the causative factors towards the development of the squinting phenomena in the patients. The lack of coordination prevents the proper binocular vision. So this is the underlying pathology. It keeps both the eyes from gazing at the same point over here. In adults, it can be due to stroke or thyroid problems. So these are the multiple endocrine conditions even that can result in the development of strabismus in a patient. The brain injury or other sorts of traumatologies, we can focus on infections, inflammations, autoimmune diseases, traumatic conditions, or even the conditions of cancerous or tumorous conditions can even result in these kind of strabismic presentations. Family history is again very important. So you're assessing the patient, you're taking the initial history taking from the patient. You're going to focus on the patient particulars. That would be the age, the name, the gender, the occupation, because some sort of occupational hazards can even be responsible for the development of strabismus in a lot of patients. Then focusing on the family history is very important. If the relatives have strabismus, person is likely to develop it. So the genetic predisposition is very important in these cases of strabismus. On the other hand, we have the past history. The past history can be the past medical as well as the past surgical history. The person can be suffering from some sort of medical conditions as thyroid problems, hypothyroid or hyperthyroidism. Both of them make them more important to the development of this nerve damage ultimately resulting in the strabismus conditions in the children. On the other hand, stroke is one of the conditions that the person may give you a history of stroke in the past or in the near past, which again will make the person more prone to strabismus. The refractive errors, if the patient is suffering from a refractive error, he or she is anisometropic, that would be a significant refractive error difference in both of the eyes. That is again one of the causative factors towards the development of strabismus. The extreme farsightedness, hyperopia, can develop strabismus in these children due to the amount of the eye focusing necessary to keep the vision clear in these individuals. The risk factors that we can see, or which are again making the person more prone to the development of this strabismic condition, are the people with Down syndrome or cerebral palsy. So these particular syndromes which are making the person more prone to the development of strabismus are Down's or cerebral palsy in the children, people who have suffered stroke or head injuries. That is extreme trauma, extreme head trauma is again one of the causative factors. Stroke is basically the TIAs, that is the transient ischemic attacks, or the stroke is again one of the causative or the risk factors. Now all of these together is going to make the person at high risk for the development of the strabismus in these people. So over here in this section, we just summed up the introduction towards this pathological condition of the eyes, which is known as strabismus, which is going to clinically present as the misalignment of the eyes. This misalignment is basically due to multiple causes, the multiple causative factors. It can be systemic causes, it can be the localized causes. So we talked about the different causative factors over here towards the development of this strabismic condition in the patient. So that is the end of this section. Thank you for watching skyu.com.